And welcome back to Let's Play Torment, Tides of Numenera. Blind, I'm the RPG chick. We're gonna let Aadiiris read our mind. I suppose I'm ready to let you probe my mind so we can find Mazoff in Mir, which is the only place we can find Mazoff, because no one knows where Mazoff physically is at this point. This will take but a moment. She places gentle fingers on your forehead, and you feel a swirl of color thrill your innermost core. A kaleidoscope of emotion shakes you, a gamut of experiences recognized and echoed, magnified and reflected. When she removes her hand, her eyes are wet with tears. Forgive my doubt, sister. I believe you now. I believe you are capable of changing reality. She thinks, why would our sire have given her this ability? A side effect, perhaps, or...
I'll remember that.
I really have to check out these quests. She holds up a slender finger. But if anything, this makes me more leery of handing you a brother's mirror caster. If you wish to speak to Mazoff, you must prove to me that you can be entrusted with the minds of one of our brethren. You cured Matkina, but did you understand Tash? Did you take care of his innermost self as well? Before I can give you this mirror caster, I would have you speak with Melmoth Leviarm. I already spoke with Melmoth Leviosa. It is my contention that we draw the sorrow to us with our abuse of the tides, which is why I do not use our tidal powers. I believe our use of these powers is inherently painful to those around us. For instance, was anyone with you when you awoke to consciousness? Painful, yes. If you throw it at other people. Like that slaver did on Rin, I forgot her name. Two people, an Aeon priest named Allegern, and a nano named Calistige. And she's actually right there. They were arguing as I awoke. I'd wager any simmering tension snapped into sharp focus. If they were lovers, for example, they might have fallen deep into love's spell. But if they were breaking apart, your blast of tidal energy would have riven them, destroyed their relationship. Oh yeah, looks like that's what happened. She pauses, and you feel the tickle of her mind on yours. That's what happened, isn't it? They were not arguing for nothing. Go see Melmoth. Ask him about the tides. When you've done that, we will speak further. Will you give me the mirror caster after that? Perhaps. Eventually. I must know that you will take responsibility when you hold Zarian's life, his history, in your hands. You will not have the mirror caster until I am satisfied. Okay, so it's Zarian's mirror caster, whom Mazoff is within. What if I don't do it? You came all this way, through the cultist of the valley and even breaking through our locked portal. What I ask is a simple thing. I'm sure you will see the wisdom of it. Go speak to Melmoth about the tides. He will have insights for you that I can likely not provide. Farewell. And you also. Calistige. Where did you grow up? Was this before? Here before? In Sega's Cliffs, for the most part. I worked my way through the content of the Grand Library in short order, and was soon writing text for it myself. Of course, there are far greater works to pursue out here. She looks around, pleased. Sega's truly is a prison for the mind. I am lucky to have escaped it. She inclines her head toward you and thanks. The library holds no answers to the questions I asked of it. She thinks. So, see, now it says, where did you grow up again? Meaning this is a new question, I think. Huh. What do you hope to accomplish? So direct. I shan't be coy, either, then. Your sire, the changing god, was a nano of surpassing ability. Your search for answers is likely to cross his trail at multiple points. He must have researched the data sphere at some point, and I hope to study his work to address my own particular situation. She waves her hands across her body. I am what you might imprecisely call a nascent cross-dimensional hive mind. Huh. What I must decide now is whether to continue this experiment. My sisters, you see, they are a blessing and a curse. One moment. She addresses them. Hush, you know it's true. I've thought it, so therefore you've thought it. We have no secrets from one another. She smiles thinly. You see, even in my thoughts we are not alone. We seek, let us call it closure of some sort, of our association, or of our individuality. Uncovering your sire's knowledge of the datasphere could likely determine my direction. If we cannot find a suitable home in the datasphere, we may have to terminate this process, but that presents pitfalls of its own. So I want to find out how your sire accessed the datasphere, to see if his work might have some applicability to my researches. Perhaps to access the datasphere myself, if that were possible. What can you tell me about the datasphere? Your creator was a genius. Many throw the word out lightly. I use it in its truest sense. He knew how to access the datasphere, and he set that knowledge aside. I will follow in his footsteps, and then I will surpass him. I will find a way to make a connection, and my sisters and I will truly understand. She chuckles lightly. Or we will back away from the precipice. We are still undecided. Its great structures exist all around us, piercing realities. This is what your sire knew. This is why he built those lovely machines in the buried crossroads. With the information he found there, the knowledge of the ancients was likely at his fingertips. She taps her lip. I do wonder why he abandoned that line of study. How did you meet Allegern? I suppose there's no harm in indulging you, she muses. You've shown yourself competent in many endeavors, and this should be no different. She ranges one sleeve diffidently. So I'm guessing that this option to ask her about this appears once we've shown ourselves competent in many endeavors. Allegern and I met when he came to the Order of Truth, seeking help. Naturally, I was intrigued by his predicament, more so than the man. She smiles, but absently. He had lost his family, you see, and sought their return. He had brought with him an odd frame of unknown origin that was central to his tale. The stuffed shirts at the Order were more interested in picking apart Allegern's story than they were in examining the frame he had brought with him. The task fell to me, so I undertook it. And for that, Allegern became enchanted with me. An odd frame. Eventually, we became lovers. He was pleasant enough in bed, I suppose, but he lacked any real enthusiasm. And the crying! She rolls her eyes, arm thrown dramatically across her forehead. This pitiful childlike snuffling when he thought I was asleep. She shakes her head in disbelief. His family was gone. There was no more he could tell me, and I had learned nothing worth telling him. You saw the end. I've moved on. Why were you and Allegern together if your relationship was so poor? Guilt. For him, at least. He desperately wanted to save someone. For me, it was a matter of necessity. She sighs and shakes her head. It was my own research that led me to this state, but despite access to 1,000 worlds, I was no closer to achieving my goal, and my sisters were ever closer to plotting my annihilation. You see, in an effort to extend my own life, I chanced upon versions of myself that would end it. It's true. Some of my echoes seek to become the sole survivors or to rule over the rest. And so I sought a way to return to my base state, if you will, a way to control my future. I had found some notes of your sire's, notes that hinted at a machine capable of merging multiple selves, of concatenating various minds into a single identity. Naturally, it seemed a welcome solution to my predicament, but his clues as to its location were useless, to the utmost degree. She frowns. Allegern had met the man, once. It was more than I had to go on, and I was feeling less than patient. She waves a hand wearily. From there, you know the rest. Did you say some of your other selves want to kill you? Why? She is silent for several long moments. I don't know, she admits. I have tried to reason with them, but they are beyond it, or at least immune to it. They blame me for opening all our minds to each other. But had it not been me, another version of me would have. In fact, it was a host of me that did. I am not alone in this. Across countless realities, we came together simultaneously. She closes her eyes briefly. I wonder, sometimes. She looks to you as if searching for an answer. Would it have been better to be one of the other Calesthesias? To have no choice in the matter but to be connected, without my prior knowledge or consent? To have my memories, my secrets, buried in 1,000 other realities, knowing they could never be used against me, but aware, all the same, that they were known? She passes a weary hand in front of her eyes. So I understand those of myself who reject this change. I do. I no more chose to share myself with them than they chose to share with me. But that does not mean I long for their destruction, nor truly think it would have any great impact on my life here. And that is where we differ. The one point on which, perhaps, we shall always disagree. Fortunately, a great many others see the matter from my perspective. So, it's interesting, because I'm thinking about Planescape Torment with the Nameless One, how he had all these other versions of himself, and they were all different. There was one who was, like, murderous, there was one who was, like, secretive, like, hiding. What can change the nature of a man? So what can change the nature of a Calesthes? They all come from different realities. So the ones that want to kill the other Calesthesias maybe, you know, we're brought up with an experience that yet we have to get rid of everyone else because we can't trust them, or we must be number one, or something like that. Because of what they've been through in life, they grew up in a different reality. Could be no more different than one person who, like, abused them or hounded them in the beginning or throughout their entire life that made them be this way. And that did not happen to this Calesthes, which is why she doesn't want to kill the other Calesthesians. This, yeah, experience, your surroundings, your environment, as it were. But of course, does Aadiiris have anything new? Let me just check. Nothing new. And Tiber had an interesting
reaction.
Never had
much use for family myself. They're one of the reasons I took to the military life as quick as I could.
Right, he did have a reaction when we were speaking to somebody. He thinks some of my family didn't have much use for me. No use I care to remember, at least. Well, you're part of a family now. Gold. Tiber starts, then clears his throat. Kind of you to say, he says, eyes averted. He makes an effort to say more, mouth moving soundlessly. Kind of you to say, he finishes lamely. He's not used to being treated like so nicely like that. He glances around at Melmoth again, a grin playing about his lips. This place has all the earmarks of a fight waiting to break out over dinner. He sidles closer. Maybe we can pinch some of the silverware and be gone before that happens, hey? So to speak. Keep your hands off the silverware. You do know how to torture a metaphor, Tiber. Torture is a strong word, he says, frowning. Pervert, perhaps. Seduce? Lead astray, he grins at you. And I have to say that the metaphors have never complained. Not enough smiling faces, not enough bars. Okay, I want to check before I go talk to Melmoth. Our journal. So, Aadiiris says she has a mirror caster in which Mazoff appears. With my abilities to change reality, I could speak with him in the mirror, but she wishes to probe my mind first to determine the truth of this tale. To be honest, I'm curious what she will find as well. We're at the Page Reckon, blah blah blah. Talk to Melmoth. Aadiiris is hesitant to let me change someone else's past without understanding the cast-off condition. She has asked me to seek out Melmoth, Levyarm, in Melevest and ask what he believes about the tides and our birth. So I guess these haven't changed? Oh, we still have to do this? That we've seen Phoenix's wisdom. I found a tomb where Phoenix left a message for himself. I must return to tell him what I found. Yes. We'll do that soon. Asked about Choi's surname, Kasul. I found Choi's marker. It had a very strange epitaph, but I learned Choi's surname is Kasul, the same as Ronos Kasul, the memorialist I met when I entered the valley. Perhaps he can shed some more light on this. I hope he would, because we did save him. Yeah, I need to find a doctor for Aretas. I spoke to Aretas, the true Aretas, in the labyrinth, before he became the man I met in Sagas. He was a simple herdsman who stumbled across a box of demons. He asked me to help drive the demons out of him and return him to the way he was. I need to find someone knowledgeable, maybe a doctor who can help him. Still, the only one I can think of is the Chirurgeon in Sagas Cliffs. It's the only real doctor I can remember meeting. Unless someone in the Order of Truth. Perhaps that Min of Tan Liang would be, he seems pretty knowledgeable. In fact, I try him first. Was this Melmoth? Here he is.
I'm ready.
Back to the raspy voice again. Oh, good. You've come to back to bedevil me again. See that? Aadiiris told me to come speak to you about the tides. You'll find none better equipped to answer the question, certainly. The tides are an inextricable part of us, and... He snaps a clamp on one of the attachments on a tube. Wait. She sends you to me? He peers closely at you. Interesting. Every time I talk about the tides, she argues with me, as if she'd spent a fraction of the time I have in studying them. He thinks, what game is Aadiiris playing? She probably said that we bring pain through our existence. Let me enlighten you. Everyone brings pain to others. I have experienced so many lives and memories, and one of the common threads in all of them is pain. Do we hurt other people? We do. But how do we differ from any mortal in this regard? Show me someone without pain, and I will show you a corpse. He winks. And then I'll eat it.
Updated my journal.
We are imperfect. We leak tides, or absorb them, or both. Our powers impinge on the minds of others, upon their nervous system, if you prefer. We draw strength from them. We change them in the process, and not usually for the better. This is regrettable, but unavoidable. Aadiiris might have said that the sorrow is hunting us because we abuse the tides, or some such nonsense. But if that's the case, we're doomed by the nature of our existence. If true, why not use the powers we have? What are the tides, anyway? Where did they come from? You know they're a psychic energy field. They pervade the greater Sagas Protectorate. But the pockets of tidal activity are localized in the Ninth World. That suggests that though they're a natural force, they're also artificially induced. Centuries have risen around their use. He frowns. And civilizations have fallen. Did I say centuries? Instead of civilizations? Okay, so they're a natural force, but artificially induced? How can you be both? He scratches his nose. Odd thing. I have sought to decipher the accounts of those times, but the creatures that made them are strange. The Sharrow shows up in images and sounds and spectra I can barely understand. He taps his head. That's why I sought a better method. You get the occasional disease. A strong mind that doesn't want to share its memories with you. but everyone wants to be remembered. Talk to the voices long enough, they realize you're their only true heir. You tell me anything more about the history of the Tides? Maybe if you eat my corpse when I'm dead, you can learn some of what I know. The knowledge I have? Too much for the spoken word. What did you mean when you said that the Tides were an inextricable part of us? Did you think that we could come back from the dead because you were born lucky? Our bodies require tidal energy. Cut us off from that energy and we dissolve. It's the way we're structured. The way our sire created us. He invented a mental matrix and imposed it on the bodies he grew. I surmise that this matrix is what allows his consciousness to transfer and what allows the tidal energy to permeate our forms. Without it, he grins and pulls his hands apart. Sploosh. But we have the advantage of being able to draw on this power for our own uses. He constructed each of us along different lines, and because of that, the patterns that hold us are different. Is it any wonder that we should be able to channel this into tidal surges? Because we have no choice. Were we to remove the tides from our bodies, the changing... I can't even say that name. Our creator wouldn't even have been able to enter these shells. Remove our connection to the tides, and we fall apart. How do you know so much about the tides? He sighs, exasperated, and holds up his bony hand, folding his fingers back as he counts. One. I am hundreds of years old. I can devote this kind of time. Two. I am dedicated to knowledge. Three. I will do anything in its pursuit. Four. I learned to draw memories from dead people. Five. I sought the dead who could teach me about the tides. He lowers his fist. Follow that trail of thought. You'll find me at the end. That's how I know. And why do I do this, do you think? Let me tell you, since you clearly wanted to ask, it's because the changing man thought the tides were important. He used the tides to shape us. Do you want to know more about how you were created? I did, and so I researched the tides. The reason for this is that I am not an idiot, unlike so many of our siblings. I seek out knowledge. I don't run around the countryside on some farcical journey. I put in the effort to find knowledge, to absorb it. That's all. Why do you think the sorrow pursues us? He waves a finger at you. I don't waste my time worrying about it. Like worrying about the death of the cosmos? It'll come sooner or later. You want supposition? Here's a list. Because of our mad creator. Vengeance. Sheer bloody-mindedness. Maybe it loves the tides, or loathes them. Could be it hates what we're doing with the tides. But if you talk to Aadiiris, say, you'll find she never uses hers. I use mine all the time. Yet the sorrow would destroy us both. Would it? He adjusts one of the tubes on his outfit. I worry more about the deaths of others, and how I might gain some of their knowledge. Not about the first dead vendetta. Nor the creator's desire to kill us, nor certainly not an unstoppable monster from the past. Because of what we are, it's ineffable. No point in trying to understand it. Just avoid it if you can. But realize that the deaths you might have to delve to succeed, well, you might have your own batch of castoffs cursing your name. Aadiiris thinks that a tidal surge on my birth was responsible for a devastating argument between two humans. It's entirely possible. The tides are a psychic force, and when we're born, our minds snap into a particular shape and force out the residue. An unprotected mind nearby might well absorb some of that energy and react in unpredictable ways. But what of it? Does this change anything in your life? Two mortals had an argument. Oh no, boo-hoo. He turns to Callistes. From the look on your face, I'd guessed one of those humans was you, he leers. Don't worry. It would have happened anyway. All the surge did was overwhelm your natural defenses and push you into a decision more quickly. He stares at her more intently. Looks as if you've plenty of experience in making rash decisions already. If you're going to keep throwing yourself into things, you really ought to improve your defenses. Be prepared. Calistia says, now a corpse eater is offering me advice? My thanks, but I will keep my own counsel. He smiles beautifully. Yes, discard the advice from a man who is centuries old and has the accumulated knowledge of untold lifetimes. This is the best decision you've made all day, I'm certain. He quirks an eyebrow at you. This is one reason why most of us cease consorting with mortals, except when we have to. We have such good advice for them, and they always ignore it. Okay. He squints at you and then relents. I just want to read this. Growling at you won't make you go away, I suppose, so ask. Farewell. Okay, so... what changed? I've talked to Melmoth about the tides. His opinion is markedly different from Aadiiris's, which makes me wonder why she sent me to him. He says that the tides are an inextricable part of who we are as castoffs, a power we should use to our benefit. All right, let us return.
Of course.
I just want to zoom in. I like the more detailed view. Have you spoken with Melmoth then? What did he say? He said that the tides are within us all and that we should use our powers as necessary. I imagine he called me a fool, and worse. He has done more research into the tides than anyone here in Mila Vest. Tell me, did he say anything else? He said I should ask where your powers come from, if not the tides. I awoke with them. They are not, as far as I am aware, any manifestation of tidal energies. It's not as though we have a measuring apparatus, of course, but I think I would know if I were using these forces. At any rate, I sent you to speak with Melmoth. Do you believe that he has conducted his studies with anything but his own power in mind? Definitely not this. I mean, maybe, but I don't think so. He seems to care deeply for the preservation of knowledge. So he says, and he has certainly gone to great lengths to do so. I don't believe in his positions, nor his conclusions, for he may well have inflated the results to justify his actions, but he refuses my mind's touch, and he rebuffs my attempts to inquire more deeply. My own personal views are, of course, irrelevant to the deeper truth, that he has his own motives, and they may be purer than mine.
I'll remember that.
So I have another task for you. Andronus and Raima are arguing. The recent negotiations between the Chalcedon and Paj broke down, and these two have taken it hard. They're likely to come to blows if they cannot be reconciled. She bows her head. If one strikes the other, the laws of Mila Vest are clear. The attacker will be evicted. I don't know if the Sorrow is truly more active, but they came here choosing safety, and it is my wish that they have it. Please, speak with them. She thinks, will she take control outside their minds as well, or will she let them choose their own path? Alright. See if there's anything else. Doesn't seem like we accomplished very much in this episode. There's a lot of text. Because I'm altering people's lives without their permission, Aadiiris would like to see how I do so when they're still in control of their lives. There are two castoffs in Mila Vest, and Jonas Sandhand and Raima Ciro, whose argument is threatening to turn violent. Aadiiris would like me to resolve this dispute and protect the peace of this sanctuary. Getting a little late, so we're going to do that next episode. Thanks so much for watching, guys. Hope to see you in the next one, and endure. In enduring, grow strong.